If you're joining us for the first time, please feel free to send me an email to pastordan@bethlehemsturbridge.org. That's, again, pastordan@bethlehemsturbridge.org, so that we can be in touch and figure out ways to share in our ministry together. Here at Bethlehem, whether we're meeting in person or gathering over Facebook, we begin our service with prayer requests of joys and concerns. If you have any requests this morning, please feel free to submit those into the comments section below this video. For what joys and concerns do we have this morning?
So from Corrine, prayers for her husband Brian and his family at the loss of his father and Corrine's father-in-law, Fred.
Prayers for Corrine and her husband and family at the loss of her father.
Her father, Fred, yes.
Father Fred, her father-in-law, Fred. We will lift up them and all who mourn and are in grief this day.
Prayers for Richard, who is fighting the virus.
We lift up Richard, who is fighting Corona or COVID-19, and for all who are in that struggle this morning.
Continue prayers for Rick in the ICU.
We continue to pray for Rick, who is currently in the ICU.
Prayers for the family of Larry Sundberg, who passed away last week.
Prayers for the family of Larry Sundberg, who passed away last week. Larry's the father of a family friend of my parents, and we lift up all of them in our prayers this morning.
Kathy Sheehan fell this week and had 19 stitches to close up the wound on her leg.
Oh, prayers for Kathy and Don and for good healing in a time where that's not easy.
Prayers of thanksgiving for Tom, who was given last rites for COVID and recovered enough the next day to get out of the ICU.
Prayers for Tom for making a recovery after having been given last rites. I'll just lift up a joy for sunshine and for warm weather and for the ability to get out and experience God's creation still in the midst of all of this.
And Boyd has one.
And Boyd.
Oh yeah, my friend's mother, Virginia Francois, is in assisted living, and she came down with the coronavirus, and she's not expected to last much longer.
Prayers for Virginia,
yeah,
as she's has come down with the virus, and prayers for her family as they move into this Seeing and hearing no other prayer requests this morning, we continue on in our service with our thanksgiving for baptism. Alleluia! Christ is risen.
Christ is risen indeed. Alleluia.
Joined to Christ in the waters of baptism, we are raised with him to new life. Let us give thanks for the gift of baptism. We give you thanks, O God, for in the beginning you created us in your image and planted us in well-watered gardens. In the desert you promised pools of water for the parched, and you gave us water from the rock. When we did not know the way, you sent the good shepherd to lead us to still waters. At the cross you watered us from Jesus' wounded side, and on this day you shower us again with the water of life. We praise you for your salvation through water, for the water in this font, for all water everywhere. Bathe us in your forgiveness, grace, and love. Satisfy the thirsty and give us the life only you can give. To you be given honor and praise through Jesus Christ our Lord, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, now and forever. Amen. We begin with our opening hymn, Come You Faithful, Raise the String, which can be found in your worship materials sent to your email and also found in the link below this video on our Facebook page.
Jerusalem, who with true affection your deep peace which evermore passes human knowing. Neither could the gates of death nor the tomb's dark portal, nor the watchers, nor the seal, hold you as a mortal. A blue day among your whichever more passes human knowing. Alleluia, now we cry to our Lord immortal, who triumphant burst the bars of the tomb's dark Son, God the Father praising. Alleluia, let again to the Spirit raising.
The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all.
And also with you. Feast and celebration, all of creation sings for joy. To the God of life and love and freedom, praise and glory forevermore. Now is the feast of the Lamb once slain, whose blood has freed and united us to be one great people of God. Now the feast and celebration, all of creation sings for joy. To the God of life and love and freedom, praise and glory forevermore. Power and riches, wisdom and might, all honor and glory to Christ forever. Now the feast and celebration, all of creation sings for joy. To the God of life and love and freedom, praise and glory forevermore. God has come to dwell with us, to make us people of God, to make all things new. Now the feast and celebration, all of creation sings for joy. The God of life and love and freedom, praise and glory forevermore.
The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
May we, who have not seen, have faith in you and receive the fullness of Christ's blessing, who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. We continue with the readings.
First reading from Acts chapter 2. Peter, standing with the 11, raised his voice and addressed the crowd. You that are Israelites, listen to what I have to say. Jesus of Nazareth, a man attested to you by God with deeds of power, wonders, and signs that God did through him among you, as you yourselves know. This man, handed to you according to the definite plan and foreknowledge of God, you crucified and killed by the hands of those outside the law. But God raised him up, having freed him from death, because it was impossible for him to be held in its power. For David says concerning him, I saw the Lord always before me, for he is at my right hand so that I will not be shaken. Therefore my heart was glad, and my tongue rejoiced. Moreover, my flesh will live in hope, for you will not abandon my soul to Hades, or let your Holy One experience corruption. You have made known to me the ways of life. You will make me full of gladness with your presence. Fellow Israelites, I may say to you confidently of our ancestor David, that he both died and was buried, and his tomb is with us to this day. Since he was a prophet, he knew that God had sworn an oath to him that he would put one of his descendants on his throne. Foreseeing this, David spoke of the resurrection of the Messiah, saying, he was not abandoned to Hades, nor did his flesh experience corruption. This Jesus God raised up, and of that all of us are witnesses. Word of God, word of life.
Thanks be to God.
Second reading from 1 Peter. Blessed be the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ. By his great mercy, he has given us a new birth into a living hope through the resurrection of Jesus Christ from the dead, and into an inheritance that is imperishable, undefiled, and unfading, kept in heaven for you who are being protected by the power of God through faith for a salvation ready to be revealed in the last time. In this you rejoice, even if now for a little while you have had to suffer various trials, so that the genuineness of your faith, being more precious than gold that, though perishable, is tested by fire, may be found to result in praise and glory and honor when Jesus Christ is revealed. Although you have not seen him, you love him. And even though you do not see him now, you believe in him and rejoice with an indescribable and glorious joy, for you are receiving the outcome of your faith, the salvation of your souls. Word of God, word of life.
Thanks be to God.
Alleluia, alleluia, Lord, to whom shall we go? You have the words of eternal life. Alleluia.
The Holy Gospel according to St. John, the 20th chapter. Glory to you, O Lord. When it was evening on that day, the first day of the week, and the doors of the house where the disciples had met were locked for fear of the Jews, Jesus came and stood among them and said, peace be with you. After he said this, he showed them his hands and his side. Then the disciples rejoiced when they saw the Lord. Jesus said to them again, peace be with you. As the Father has sent me, so I send you. When he had said this, he breathed on them and said to them, receive the Holy Spirit. If you forgive the sins of any, they are forgiven. If you retain the sins of any, they are retained. But Thomas, who was called the twin, one of the 12, was not with them when Jesus came. So the other disciples told them, we have seen the Lord. But he said to them, unless I see the mark of the nails in his hands and put my finger in the mark of the nails and my hand in his side, I will not believe. A week later, his disciples were again in the house, and Thomas was with them. Although the doors were shut, Jesus came and stood among them and said, peace be with you. Then he said to Thomas, put your finger here and see my hands. Reach out your hand and put it in my side. Do not doubt, but believe. Thomas answered him, my Lord and my God. Jesus said to him, have you believed because you have seen me? Blessed are those who have not seen and yet have come to believe. Now Jesus did many other signs in the presence of his disciples, which are not written in this book. But these are written so that you may come to believe that Jesus is the Messiah, the Son of God, and that through believing, you may have life in his name. This is the gospel of the Lord. Thanks be to God. Our sermon this morning comes to us from our bishop, Jim Hazelwood, from the New England Synod.
Says, unless I see the evidence, unless I put my finger in his hands, my hand in his side. And in other words, unless I have a tactile, concrete experience, I'm not going for it. Now a week later, okay, now we're to today. Jesus appears to the disciples. This time, Thomas is with them. He actually walks through the door, goes right over to Thomas. They have this exchange where Jesus invites him, touch me. And out of that, Thomas says, my Lord. Jesus then says that saying that goes down through the ages, essentially a version of, you have believed because you've seen, you've touched. Blessed are those who believe and have not seen. I'm very grateful for this particular story in the Gospels. I'm glad that the writers of the Gospels included it, because I think it affirms something that we all experience. Doubt, wonder, curiosity. But before we go on, let's talk a little bit and get clear on what I mean by doubt. You see, there's some other perspectives that are prevalent in our culture today. One would be the cynic. Now, a cynic is different than a doubter. A cynic is someone who once imagined ideals like truth and justice, but after some disappointments in life, they've come to say, nah, not for me. Then another person could be what's called a nihilist, nihilistic tendencies. This is someone who, having failed to find anything redeeming in themselves or in the world, just wishes to eradicate hope and truth and promise from everyone's life. And then the third is a doubter. A doubter is someone who deep down longs for, hungers for, desires truth, meaning, hope, and love. They just wonder. They just wonder when they're going to see it. Wonder and doubt. I want to read for you a sonnet. I recently came across the Anglican priest, Malcolm Gate, who has a collection of really wonderful sonnets. Now, I have not really been a fan of sonnets. In fact, I don't think I've really read many sonnets since I had a class in Shakespeare a very long time ago. Malcolm Gate has brought those back to life for me. Listen to this one, which is called St. Thomas the Apostle. We do not know. How can we know the way? Courageous master of the awkward question, you spoke the words the others dared not say, and cut through their evasion and abstraction. Oh, doubting Thomas, father of my faith, you put your finger on the nub of things. We cannot love some disembodied wraith, but flesh and blood must be our king of kings. Your teaching is to touch, embrace, anoint. Feel after him and find him in the flesh. Because he loved your awkward counterpoint, the word was heard and granted you your wish. Oh, place my hands with yours. Help me, divine, the wounded God whose wounds are healing mine. I don't know about you, but I think that's wonderful. Maybe it's not doubting Thomas. Maybe it's wondering Thomas. What are some things you're wondering about these days? Health comes to mind first, yours and others that you know. The economy in general, and specifically your job or your spouse's job or a friend or family member's employment. And how are you going to get through these times? And then there's democracy. Its fragile state, fragile it has always been, and hanging in the balance. Health, the economy, democracy, those are things I wonder about right now. We are now living in a time of ambiguity. Certainty has left us. And Thomas is probably our disciple of these days, these times. Thomas embraces a time of ambiguity. He wonders, he doubts, and as the poet Malcolm Gate writes, you know, he leads us forward. Ambiguity is hard, but for Lutherans, it's actually something we do well. And for New England Lutherans, we do it especially well because we have this Yankee libertarian independence. We are on our own. There are in Maine and New Hampshire and Vermont long driveways that you drive down to get to someone's home. Symbolic of a certain sense of, I'm on my own down here, I'm okay. But one of the things that is also true that we need to balance out our Yankee independence with is our now global interdependence. For if nothing else, COVID-19 has revealed to us many, many things, but one of the truths is that we are indeed interconnected. We are interdependent. We are a global society. We cannot run from that. It is who we are. It is the world we have made. And so in this interconnectedness, I think there's also something for us to remember in these days. We need one another. We are at our best when we are with one another, whether those be neighbors or relatives, near or far. We cannot go alone on this path. We have to go this path with each other. I have to say, one of the things that has really impressed me in the last month is the ways I am seeing our congregations, our campus ministries, our hospital chaplains, our camps, all of the ministries of the New England Synod. I have been impressed with the way we are functioning. I am not hearing lots of histrionics. I'm not hearing lots of complaining. In fact, I'm hearing less of it than before all this. We are really rising to the occasion. So that gives me tremendous hope. What I'm seeing, the way you are reaching out to your neighbors, the way you are continuing your ministries of feeding and hungry, the way you are keeping the concerns of our global partners in Honduras and the Holy Land foremost in your minds, the way you are praying for others, we're doing this about the best we can. And so I want to close with a story. It actually comes from another tradition. I believe it's Native American in its origin. And it's a story that I've learned over time. And it's often at times like this, it has helped me. And maybe it will be helpful for you. The story is of a woman, an old woman, who is in a cave. It's a symbolic story, don't take it literally. And she is weaving a great, beautiful, beautiful blanket with all kinds of intricacies, and parts of it are very unique, and parts of it are just glorious with color, and parts of us are dark, and other parts are light. It reflects all of the shades. It's really a cosmic story that's being told. It's about all of creation, all of its beauty and majesty. And at one point, the old woman gets up, having woven this beautiful blanket, this tapestry of all God's creation. And she gets up and she walks away, goes to attend to a pot, a on the stove where she's doing some cooking. While she's away, a dog or a coyote or a hoopster, a mischievous creature comes along and sees that there's a little frail, thread at the end of this blanket and pulls on it. And pulls on it, and pulls on it, and pulls on it, and pulls on it, and unravels. And when she returns to her gorgeous, once gorgeous blanket, it's now just a mess. It's yarn everywhere. And so she sits down, and she sees a thread, and she reaches down, and she picks it up, and she starts knitting. And knitting, and starts to weave an even more beautiful blanket. Now, that's a story filled with lots of rich symbolism. And it's an old story that's told in cultures as a reminder that when things get bad, yes, some things can get pulled apart. But in that particular story, what gets woven the next time is even more beautiful. I connect that story to what we have experienced in the last 6 to 7 weeks. I don't just mean the coronavirus and the pandemic, although that, but I mean the story of our journey from Lent through Holy Week. The movement and the power of the hope of Christ, who is the embodiment of love and truth and promise and hope, that prevails, that went through deceit and betrayal and corruption and lying and cheat and arrest and crucifixion and death and burial, and yet that's not the final word. The final word is that hope wants to, yearns to be alive in the world. Thomas is our guide through all that. His desire to touch, to put his hands in the wounds is something that I think we follow as we go through it, into it. We touch the wounds, and the wounded God is the God that heals us and will heal all of God's creation. This will pass, my friends, and on the other side, hope will prevail. Amen.
By faith and not by sight, with gracious words drawn near. O Christ, who spoke as none has spoke, my peace be with you here. Lift not your hands and side, nor follow where you trod, but in your promise we rejoice and cry, my Lord and God. And endure our unbelief, and may our faith abound to call you, Lord, lead us. resurrected Lord, our fountain means divine. Beneath the water and the word, beneath the bread and wine. And when our life of faith is done, in realms of clearer light, may we behold you as you are, with full and endless light.
We confess our faith with the church around the world in the words of the Apostles' Creed.
I believe in God, the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, God's only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended to the dead. I believe in him again. He ascended to heaven. He is seated at the right hand of the Father, and he will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen.
Uplifted by the promised hope of healing and resurrection, we join the people of God in all times and places in praying for the church, the world, and all who are in need. Open the doors we close, O God, when we fear those who worship you in different ways. Guide us to unity and harmony so that we may come to respect and cherish our commonalities. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Open the paths we ignore, O God, when we prioritize financial gain and convenience over listening to the growing of the earth. Inspire all to care for the world you have made so that living things might thrive. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Open the rooms we lock, O God, to those who live without a homeland or place of safety. We pray that generous nations offer refuge and peace for all. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Open the hearts we close, O God, to the cries of those in pain. We pray for those isolated physically or emotionally through incarceration, addiction, mental illness, chronic suffering, or grief. Lord, today we especially pray for Richard and Virginia as they fight the virus, for their families and support systems, for Rick in the ICU, for Kathy Sheehan in healing and for Dawn in support, and for Lori as she recovers at home. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Open the ways of love, O God, in the pursuit of peace throughout the world, and bless the efforts of missionaries, healthcare professionals, activists for women and children, and relief workers, and especially those who find themselves in harm's way. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Open the way to eternal life, O God, as we remember those who have died in faith. We pray for Fred, Brian Kareen's father, and we pray for Larry Sonberg and their family, as they remember their lives. Free us from the fear of death, that we may embrace the peace you have promised. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
With bold confidence in your love, Almighty God, we place all for whom we pray into your eternal care. And today we especially lift up the joys of the beauty of God's creation, for our congregation who remain faithful, though virtual, for Tom's recovery after last rites, and we pray for all those essential workers that keep us healthy, fed, and and supply. Through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
The peace of Christ be with you always. And also
with you.
Let us share a Facebook comment, like, love, or laugh of peace with one another. Remembering God's overflowing new life among us, let us gather our tithes and offerings together. This morning there are two ways that you can share your offering. The first is by visiting our website, www.bethlehemservage.org, and scrolling down to the bottom of the page to find the donate section. This is where you can find a link to PayPal. Simply click on the donate button to be directed to the donation page where you can use your PayPal account or debit or credit card to make your offer. The second is that you can still mail your offering to the church. You can address your envelope to Bethlehem Lutheran Church, 345 Main Street, Sturbridge, Massachusetts, 01566. Again, that's Bethlehem Lutheran Church, 345 Main Street, Sturbridge, Massachusetts, 01566. As we contemplate lifting our gifts to God, we continue with an offertory reflection from Victor Matheson.
God has shown.
not scattered on the hill, were gathered into one to become a bread. So may all your people from all the ends of earth be gathered into one in you. As this cup of blessing is shared within our midst, may we share the presence of your love. As the grains of wheat once scattered on the hill were gathered into one to become a bread, so may all your people from all the ends of earth be gathered into one in you. Let this be a foretaste of all that is to come, when all creation shares this feast with you. As the grains of wheat once scattered on the hill were gathered into one to become a bread, so may all your people from all the ends of earth be gathered into one in you.
Let us pray. Merciful God, our ordinary
gifts seem small for such a celebration, but you make them an abundance, just as you do with our lives. Feed us again at this table for service in your name, in the strength of the risen Christ. Amen.
Lord, remember us in your kingdom and teach us to pray.
Our Father in heaven,
hallowed be your name.
Your kingdom come, your will be done, on earth as in heaven. Give us today our daily bread. Forgive us our sins as we forgive those who sin against us. Save us from the time of trial and deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever. Amen.
Praise to you, O God of mercy, thanks be to you forever. Raising high the weak and lowly, thanks be to you forever. Strong, loved and sought us, thanks be to you forever. Truth and justice you have taught us, thanks be to you forever. Strong is your faithfulness, strong is your love. Remembering your covenant of life with us. Praise to you, O God of mercy, thanks be to you forever. Giving high the weak and lowly, thanks be to you forever. Thanks be to you forever.
May God bless us and keep us. May God's face shine on us and be gracious to us. May God look on us with favor and give us peace.
Amen.
A few announcements. Right after the service, I will open up our Zoom room so we can gather together. Give me a few minutes to get that going. For our digital coffee hours, so I hope to see you on Zoom. Tomorrow night, council meets also on Zoom at 7 o'clock. So council members, looking forward to seeing you and checking in with one another there. Wednesday, again, we will have our midweek Zoom check-in. from 6 to 7. Again, I'm looking forward to seeing you on Zoom. And I will announce that Camp Calumet has been doing holding evening prayer shortly following our Zoom check-in, which I've been sharing a link to on our Facebook page. That's one of the things that has been nourishing me, and I know some others in the congregation in this time. And there are usually anywhere between 40 and 70 who tune in for that, and it's really a beautiful way to find some midweek worship during this time. Those are all the announcements I have. Are there any announcements coming to us from the from the Facebook world or from either Boyd, Dave, or Victor?
I guess if anyone's interested in gardening, that could be something that we could do socially distanced. We have some plants that are seeded at the moment. If others are interested, we can start to reconvene on that. And if folks are interested in setting up a schedule or something like that, we can figure that out and still keep that ministry going.
Great.
There's also confirmation class on Friday.
There is. We are having a confirmation and youth group check-in on Friday at 7 o'clock on Zoom. An opportunity for students and families to connect. And I think I figured out how to do Pictionary on Zoom. So we're going to give that a go and share some time of connection and fellowship. So that should be good. It'll be an experiment. I don't think there's any other announcements at this point. So we will continue with our sending hymn. Alleluia, Jesus is risen, found in your worship materials.
Is risen, trumpets resounding in glorious light, splendor the Lamb, heaven forever. Oh, what a miracle God has in sight! Jesus is risen, and we shall arise. Give God the glory, alleluia. Walking the Christ in the center, telling the story to open your eyes, giving us glory, Jesus our blessing, our constant surprise. Jesus is risen and we shall arise, give God the glory, alleluia. Jesus the vine, we are the branches, life in the Spirit, the fruit of the tree. Heaven to earth, Christ to the people, gift of the future now flowing to me. Jesus is risen and we shall arise, give God the glory, alleluia. Weeping be gone, sorrow be silent, death put asunder and Easter is bright. Cherubim sing, O grave be open, clothe us in wonder, adorn us in light. Jesus is risen and we shall arise, give God the glory, alleluia. Of God, Easter forever, golden Jerusalem, Jesus the Lamb, river of life, saints and archangels.
angels sing with creation to God the I Am. Jesus is risen and we shall arise. Give God the glory, alleluia.
Go in peace, set your hope in Christ.
Thanks be to God.